Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Artwives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Artwives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access. Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. I'm Susan Merrick and today we're here with Hermione Wiltshire. Hermione is a British artist and a senior lecturer at the Royal College of Art, London. Hello, Hermione.
Hello. Thank you for having me today.
You're really welcome. So you've had a beautiful long career so far. I would like to go back to some of your earlier works to start with, just to ask about where the work came from. So the work I'm referring to is images and sculptures of the cervix, of there were ice penises, lots of bodily work, work around body politics. Is that where you started? And if so, why? What got you into that area?
It's such a wonderful question because it's something I think about still to this day in my 50s, almost daily. I started off with that. I was at college in the mid-80s, and the early 80s, actually. I first started my degree in 1982. And I think I came with a sense of a body that I had and I lived in and I experienced and felt, but one which didn't, that was at odds with the dominant contemporary, both history of art and contemporary art landscape that I was so interested in and that I was studying. So if you think about that in terms of history of art, Renaissance, I remember a wonderful, wonderful teacher and lecturer of the Renaissance art who I enjoyed very much, but I did not find myself anywhere in that discourse. And I think that my way of making art, beginning to make art, I studied sculpture, so it was very material, was incredibly physical. That's what sculpture gave me. It gave me the opportunity to work with materials and to think through materials, to use objects when actually my experience as a very young woman was of being an object, as is most women's, within a sort of predominant cultural attitudes towards the body. I was also brought up in a peculiarly ambivalent background where on the one hand it was very louche in 1970s and 1960s and 70s and very hippie, and on the other hand a small provincial town, Catholicism, class, and the class system in this country, as we all know, is very sort of profoundly affects how we all behave and what is considered appropriate and acceptable. So I came to art with this sort of more or less unmediated body, if you like, and unmediated materials in terms of clay, in terms of wax, in terms of plaster, and I began there.
Incredible. Thank you. You went from looking at individual elements of the body. And then slightly later on in your work, you see images of scenes of sexual acts and scenes of birth. How did you go from
one type of work to the other, or one area of the body to the other, and which came first, actually, in terms of those works?
Okay, so that's also a sort of lineage which I can trace quite clearly. I think when I first began making art, I'm actually visualising myself as a sculpture student in the basement in Southampton Row at Central School of Art. I started with what I knew. So that was, as I said, my body, but it was also what I could see. So that was things like my hands, my breasts, if you like, or the organs that were visible on the outside of my body. So I started working with that. Now, of course, I was very interested in sexuality, as everybody is, and I also knew that I wanted to talk about the power relationships between men and women, because that's what I was experiencing physically and emotionally in my life. And so that's when I started using genitalia, not as a as has often been kind of thrown at me to make people feel embarrassed because of explicitness, but much more to do with trying to talk about the power relationships between the genders. So again, I did that very intuitively and very visually, and very much with materials. I was almost a bit like a child trying to get out a kind of dildo and get out a sort of something that represented the vulva and sort of make them have a conversation in front of me, a bit like a child would with a piece of two pieces of Lego. Initially, it started off like that. Oh, let's see what happens. Oh, he says that to her and she says that to him. Something like that. But then, obviously, my education began in this period of time in the 1980s where, on the one hand, I learned about Renaissance art history and that the whole of the world started with Giotto and nothing else existed before, which I later found out in Italy was not true. And also with a very sort of Marxist liberal studies program, which was going on at the same time as part of art degrees at that time. But also feminism. And at the time, the landscape was very, there were very few players in it. There was Helen Chadwick, who was my tutor. There was Susan Hiller, who was a very present voice in London in the 1980s and was all the way up until she died recently. And there was also Mary Kelly, who was, although American, was working at Goldsmith's, where we are today. And I sensed that with both interest and also anxiety, I think, because it was to do with principles and political principles that I didn't really at that stage understand. And I didn't have a greater framework of either political or philosophical or theoretical principles to be able to place my own practice. And that's what I've spent a long time trying to get down. And so as I did that, and as I gradually was able to do that more more fluently, that was when I was able to talk more about institutions, the architecture, about more, not broader isn't the right word, but perhaps more general political problems that I encountered. So when I went to Rome to as a scholar, I was very excited to have the residency. It's absolutely incredible. At the same time, it's
when did you go to Rome?
I went to Rome in 1994.
Okay.
So it, as a Rome scholar. And it's what you, they still do the opportunity at the British School that people after they finish their MA can apply to spend time in a studio there. And the studio's very, very famous. Barbara Hepworth was there in the 30s, north-facing, old-fashioned studios, really gorgeous. But what interested me when I got there, I suppose, was how entrenched the knowledge in that city is. It's you feel it all the time. It's in the earth. It's in the buildings built into the walls, and at the same time, how entrenched the attitudes were towards sexuality. So I found this story about Pietro Aretino, about these drawings that were originally commissioned by the papal courts and put on the walls of the papal courts, and they were supposed to be very spiritual drawings to decorate, and Marc Antonio Raimondi made them very carnal, and he was consequently reprimanded, and it was already a scandal. And Pietro Aretino, who was a very provocative poet and speaker of the day, public figure of the day, then published this book, which had his poems on the right-hand side and reinterpreted engravings on the left-hand side. And the engravings were people engaged in sexual acts not as characterized as gods or goddesses, just regular mortals. And then the poems were in street Italian, not in Latin. So, of course, the book it was the beginning of the printing press. It was the beginning of what I was really interested in, was the beginning of the dissemination of knowledge. So they were furious, and they destroyed the original copper plates, and then henceforth they tried to find all the books that had already gone out into circulation, and henceforth people appeared in France, in London, saying, "I found the remnants of Imodi, and there weren't 16 positions, there are 21, here they are," and they would reprint their own versions and reinterpret this wonderful story. So what I loved about it partly was that we were just starting to think about storage of knowledge on the internet, and this was the point at which it was about storage of knowledge in books and illiterate, the beginning of the printing and beginning of literacy across the populace. But also I was really, really interested in linking the knowledge of the body acquired not in books, and the knowledge and philosophical knowledge. So linking the brain and the body, if you like, and saying that this knowledge of the body is also about acquiring, that they're two different knowledges. Let's try and say this a bit better. There are two different knowledges. One is the knowledge of the body, which is non-authorized. The other is the knowledge which is authorized and which is stacked in all these exquisite libraries. So I photographed a whole series of all these gorgeous libraries in the middle of Rome. And then I found the earliest version of the Marc Antonio Raimondi 16 positions, the Imodi. And I traced around the outline of the earliest versions that I could find reproductions of, and then cut into the metal, framed the images of the libraries. So, and what I was so excited about, actually, it's really important, was that you look through the frame of the body. The body no longer have this problem of photography and explicitness. Because the body just becomes a frame through a window through which you look. And there you find this ornate and exquisite architecture and all these books.
Well, that answers my next question already really beautifully, because I wanted to consider a bit your journey from sculpture to photography to architecture, which I know you've spoken about, you've taught as well. And I can see that really clearly now in these images. And if any of the listeners haven't seen these images, they look almost like portals in a wall, as you say, like a window. So you're looking through and seeing a room beyond or a library beyond, but through the image of these two bodies in a sexual act. So that is really clear to me where all these connections are coming, and then the different directions that you've gone on with. What did you, where did you take your work from there? What came next?
So it's interesting because that relationship with photography was started before that. So when I was at college at Central School of Art and Design, very, very luckily, I had access to not only your regular standard black and white darkroom, but a colour darkroom. So I learned how to print. So my immediate desire was to put together colour photographs with coloured materials. So you had a link between an image of something and printed and the material in a form. And the early works that I made when I was a student and subsequently actually combined photography in that way. And at that time, what I was interested in was representation and whether an image of a material or an object was more powerful. I literally saw it in terms of power than the object itself. So could you have like a dusty little object or an apple, say, and is it more valuable than a picture of it? Because at the time in UK, this was the decade of advertising, and advertising was exquisite during the 80s. It was amazing, and all those, the Ridley Scott brothers have gone off to be famous Hollywood directors, and an incredible amount of money was thrown into advertising, and the visual language was incredibly rich, and artists were really interested in it. So I saw it like that. I saw that there was such a buzz in the photograph of an object, but I was also really interested in materiality. So I used to almost have tried to find a sort of equivalence between the picture and the object. And then, as you say correctly in the Imodi, I kind of extended that to spaces because I realized how powerful those spaces were and how much they spoke. And in fact, the first time I showed Imodi was in a very small Roman gallery in Trastevere. And each of the walls was quite small, so those wasn't like a gigantic industrial style gallery. So each of those Imodi pieces, one fitted on each wall. So they're quite domestic in scale, in a sense. I did it once, very reluctantly, in a show in Nottingham where I put them in a frieze, and it was entirely wrong. I just couldn't bear it. It was just, I didn't want them to be a Nancy Spiro-style frieze. I wanted them to be exactly, as you said, a portal through which you could look into another space, an imaginative space. Mm-hmm. And then subsequently I went on to use more photography, but I'm also, I've got a whole research project called The Physical Image, where I'm really interested in the physical qualities of photography, and that photographs must go somewhere, and that they must sit on a surface. Even if they're projected and they're only light, they have to sit on a surface, and there is a source of light. So those qualities of photography, I think, are incredibly important. And they affect us, but they're not always spoken about. And it comes up a lot in the teaching that I do in the photography program.
So that's a series of lectures you have as well, am I right?
It is, actually, yes.
Is that something that we can access online?
Currently not, but you will be able to later this year, actually, because I'm representing it again at a conference later in the year in France, so it will be published then.
Okay, great. That's a selfish request there. So I'd like to move on to your work around the birthing body. I was really, really struck by one particular image, which is called Birth Scene with Siblings, where, for anyone who hasn't seen it, there is a woman on all fours. There is someone attending her, and there are also two of her children who are almost in the shadows. You don't see, and you just clearly see this this woman who's labouring, about to give birth, turning her face to look up at the camera. And as I've written here in my note, she was almost challenging you to look or ask, what are you doing? What are you looking at? And it was, it really, yeah, it really struck a chord with me. So where did that series of works come from? And I know that you still have connections with Birthrights, where you have your work is part of that. Where does that play within your practice and your life?
So the birth of the image is quite a new series that has been made in collaboration with Claire Bottomley, which is really important to say, when in fact she works here at Goldsmiths University. But I'll go back, if you like, to where birth, how I got to that, which is that pregnancy, all the way back into the 90s when I was making work about sexuality, I actually made a piece of work at the British Council Gallery in Prague, commissioned by André Cook. The gallery no longer exists, but at that time she commissioned me to make a piece of work in what was called the Window Gallery. And I actually photographed Sonia Boyce when she was very pregnant with her first baby. And the reason I was interested in that is I was interested in the linea negra. And the linea negra, the line that goes up from the pubis up to the navel, is more pronounced in darker skin. Mm-hmm. And it also beautifully disappears, which is also so incredible, appears in pregnancy, disappears. So I was interested in the way the linea negra was strong and evident. So I photographed her from the front. I was also really interested in the fact that pregnancy was evidence of sexual activity. And I was always looking for, I was always so aware of the invisibility of women's desire. And at the time of making this piece, which is called A Pressing Engagement, it's a huge photograph, 3 meters by 2 meters, pressed onto a curved window on the corner of this building, the British Council Gallery in Prague, effectively making the building pregnant. And I was interested in the fact that this connects with the architecture spatial interest that I have that you mentioned earlier. The pregnant tummy pushes into space. So it's a little bit like an erect penis in the sense that it pushes into space. It's in the way. If you hug somebody when they're pregnant, the tummy is pushing literally into your body. So that was why it matched for me to have this huge tummy describing the curve, pushing into the street. So that was my interest in the connection between sexuality and birth. I made another piece that was the Irish Arts Council commissioned, which was an alien's head made up of 2 profile pictures of the pregnant tummy made into this sort of peculiar shaped alien-y head, which I printed in the middle of the editorial page. And which the editors of the Waterford, of the Munster Express, did not want there, but we paid for the double page spread. So it's literally like the alien landed in the middle of the weekly newspaper. And we wanted it in the editorial page, but they absolutely categorically didn't want it. They thought it was a monster. And what I was interested in with that was the threat of the unborn baby and the threat of the other and the fact that we don't know our babies when they're inside us. And the anxiety about the other, which was also being reflected in Ireland at the time by a very powerful xenophobia towards people who weren't Irish. And many people had tried to come to UK and got stuck in Dublin because of the immigration laws at the time. And there was a lot of friction. And I also found, sorry to Waterford people, it to be quite a sexist place. And that not things like me going into a pub when I was doing the research and asking for a drink was very problematic for the locals there. So an old-fashioned, quite parochial atmosphere in this city encouraged me to make that piece. So there we had a sort of resistance, if you like, to the birthing body. And then in 2008, Helen Knowles got in touch with me and commissioned me to make this be part of the Birthrights, original Birthrights exhibition. And then the whole relationship, which is still incredibly vibrant, started off with the Birthrights collection.
Fantastic. I know you had a couple of exhibitions towards the end of last year with regard to your work that's in the Birthrights collection. Could you tell us a bit more about those, please?
So I made two pieces initially in 2008 for the Birthrights exhibition. One of them was a series of photographs of women who were in doing exercises, antenatal exercises, designed by an alternative birth educator, yoga birth educator called Kathleen Began, who still does classes in Streatham, and who's a really wonderful teacher, yoga birth teacher. And in contrast to that, I went to regular NCT antenatal classes, and they were surprising to me because they were at the time free, and they didn't seem to actually mention the actual birth. They
talked. Did you go as an artist? You mean you went as part of your research? Or
yes.
Were you?
Yeah. And I found this really fascinating because this is knowledge that was being disseminated on by virtue of government funding. And yet, when all these pregnant mums and dads were arriving at the antenatal classes, the actual event of what actually happened inside the woman's body and about to happen outside them, but was not mentioned. And I found that's what got me very interested in crowning. And I talked a lot to the president of the NCT at the time about why this was. And she'd actually omitted the two teaching aids that had crowning in them from the teaching aids that she used and she publicised and used in her lessons. And that really fascinated me because I wanted to know why and what was the problem. And she said it was too frightening and that the stretching would frighten women. So that began my sort of great interest in the image of crowning. As a sort of counter to that, I found this incredible photograph in reproduction in the Ina May Gaskin book. And Helen was in touch with Ina May Gaskin through one of the other residencies that she was organising. And so I had the chance to talk to her on the phone and asked her about this picture. And she offered to send it to me.
Okay, wow.
So she sent me this incredible photograph taken in the late 70s, early 80s, and I received it in the post, and she said, please, I give you permission, please put the photograph on the wall of every single labour ward that you can find, 3 metres high, she said, put it everywhere, spread the word. And so I re-photographed that and presented that as my sort of counterclaim, if you like, to this absence of the crowning that was in the NCT classes. And subsequently, that piece of work has caused lots and lots of very intense responses. And it's that piece of work that was exhibited at the TJ Bolting Birth Show, which was curated by Charlotte Jansen from the Elephant magazine, and TJ Bolting, which is Hannah Watson. And then immediately afterwards, it was part of an exhibition called Matrescence, the part one of the exhibition curated by Catherine McCormack, called Matrescence at the Richard Saltoun Gallery. And part two is currently on show at the moment.
So we can go and see that now.
You can, although to raise an ecstatic childbirth is not up on show as yet. And there were a whole series of of taking downs, of censoring, of no, we're not going to put that on the wall, no, please take it down and put it back in the cupboard, that we have experienced, particularly recently. But there was absolutely no problem with exhibiting at TJ Bolting or at Richard Saltoun, no problem at all. But on the walls of a hospital or a university, no, not a hospital, on the walls of a university, that is much more problematic.
If anybody wants to see the work of the Birthrights Collection or any of your more recent work in this field, where can they see it?
So, Therese and Ecstatic Childbirth is currently not on the wall. So Helen Knowles has negotiated and renegotiated quite a lot of the works, like 17 artworks, as part of the collection, and replaced them, reinstalled them in different buildings, because where she first installed them, people in that particular building weren't happy, and it's very, very interesting for me to try to examine exactly what was the problem. And in fact, Helen and I are just co-writing something together, a paper together, where we're trying to account for exactly what the problem was. And in fact, I've just re-listened this morning, because I'm writing about it, to an orientation session that Helen and I held with doctors, midwives, building manager and technician who worked in that building. And I did record this conversation when we were trying to calm down the upset that this piece of work and one of the other pieces of work had caused. And it's so fascinating, where I think that in this historic medical institution, where sexual reproduction is examined in a medical environment, it's also very problematic to have a kind of live woman, a photograph of a very alive woman who may or may not be experiencing pleasure or even orgasm at the same time as birth, giving birth and crowning her baby's head. I think that it's the physicality of that photograph which is so problematic and really triggers both men and women alike. And I think it's something to do with the women not being objects. And I think in that context of the hospital, of King's College London, it's something to do with them having to encounter a live, desirous woman who might argue or shout or misbehave, and not an object, a woman that they can't actually confine as an object. I mean, I just went to see the Portraying Pregnancy exhibition at the Foundling Museum, and it was beautiful, some really, really beautiful things in it. But one of the things that were most arresting for me was seeing the engraving, the Hunter engraving of the corpse at 7 months pregnant. And I keep thinking about how extraordinary that moment was for them to actually be able to find out what was underneath the skin of a nine-month pregnant woman. But at the same time, the fact that this body is dead, and that although it was seen as incredibly exquisite engraving, the beginning of modern medicine, the viewing what was the interior of the body, the fact that this is a corpse, you just can't escape. And in contrast to Therese's ecstatic crowning, admittedly that photograph was taken a long time ago, but the fact that she's so alive and the fact that she's experiencing these extreme feelings in her body, I think it's that is so controversial, because it affects feelings in the viewer. When we look at those pictures or a picture like that, we're affected by it. It's very sexy and very joyful, and it emits those feelings in us when we look at it. Yeah. And I think it's that is very problematic for the medical world.
I think it comes back down to discomfort and power again, doesn't it? Those power relationships between women and women's bodies, and those who potentially are used to controlling them or viewing them, maybe.
I think it absolutely does. And I was writing last year about Jane Sharp. Well, actually, I was writing about the Birthrights Collection Summer School, which Helen and I have inaugurated last year, 2019, and which will be running again in 2020. And I was writing about the curriculum and how we generated that and the effects of that on our very first year that we ran it. And through doing that, I was looking at this book by Jane Sharp called The Midwives Book, which is 1767 or something like that. And this is a midwife who wrote a book, a book for other midwives from her experience. And in this book, she talks about educating other women, getting themselves educated as midwives. And this is the first book that was actually written from experience as opposed to theoretical. The other two texts that were used up until that point were written by men, and they were entirely theoretical, and the men hadn't attended a birth. So this was extraordinary to me, that this power play that you mentioned was still at work then. She even spoke about it then. She talked about how the lodestone draws the semen up towards the womb. She talked about the womb as having agency, the womb as being part of sexual reproduction, not as simply a vessel to be filled with the semen. So already then you can see evidence of this tension between the power play that was going on. And also at that time, apparently, men would be encouraged to be male midwives, and she was trying to get women to go and say, you know, go and educate yourselves, in spite of the fact that it was very hard for women to get educated at that time. So these power plays, I think, have been going on for a very, very, very long time. And now what preoccupies me is that they're so embedded so deeply within institutions that it's very difficult to change them. And a lot of my energy now goes into trying to examine and the structures of those power plays and trying to challenge them.
Hermione, you were talking about the birth of the image and where that was going recently. Could you expand on what's happening at the moment with that?
So this series that I made with Claire Bottomley, it isn't finished yet. We've done 7 so far. It's called The Birth of the Image, and they are reenactments of paintings in photography studios using all the contemporary vernacular of the contemporary photography studio, i.e. with lights and with contemporary clothes in them. And we are rearranging or reimagining classic narratives that we know so well within Christian scenes. It began with the birth scene because I was very interested in the fact that the nativity was a birth scene, but we never actually saw the baby coming out or a midwife or the orientation of the birthing body in the position that you would actually birth in. So we only see the beautiful Virgin Mary sitting clothed with the babe in her arms. So that was our first one that we did, birth scene. And what was really became incredibly important was that the women that were photographed, that were modelling, are their own professions, are in the field of the subject of the scene. So the woman at the front of, in the foreground of that picture, is a very, very well-known British midwife called Becky Reed, who is local to where we are now. She was found one of the founder members of the Albany midwifery practice, which worked out of King's for 14 years. And she was very controversially, her practice was closed, and allegations were made against her, which she spent 3.5 years clearing her name, and all the allegations were dropped. Becky, I got in touch with her because I was interested in finding pictures of crowning, but what was important was that she came in and she's a real midwife. Then we went on subsequently to do a picture of St. Anne, a reenactment, if you like, of St. Anne teaching the scriptures to baby Mary, to child Mary. And the role of St. Anne is Professor Hilary Robinson, Professor of Art History at Loughborough University, incredibly well-known authority on feminist art. Then we went on to do another one, The Annunciation, with a young medical humanities scholar called Jesse Olsenko-Grin, who played the part of Angel Gabriel, holding the home pregnancy, the very first home pregnancy test called the Predictor, in his fingers. And this was invented by Margaret Crane in New York in the 60s, and was literally the very first home pregnancy test that a woman could use. And he's using the predictor to announce a pregnancy to Mary. Fourth, the most exciting one we've just done recently is with Nadia Al-Ali, who was a professor of gender studies at SOAS and is now professor of anthropology at Brown University in the USA. Much of her work is about gender and about gender violence in the Middle East, and about transnational mobilization of knowledge across different sites of conflict in the Middle East. She is playing the role of Susanna in Susanna and the Elders. So she is trying to get the two harassers to back off. So in each of these pictures, we've got the woman, the character, the female character, reorganizing the narrative from their own point of view and instilling agency into it by treating the narrative differently, if you like, rearranging the narrative. And the photographs will be exhibited soon.
I have one more question, Hermione. We're running out of time. I've got Amy waving at me in the corner. But I'd really like to, just before we came in to record, you mentioned how beneficial teaching has been to you in terms of being able to frame your work, not only your earlier work, but the whole continuum of work. Could you just briefly tell me a bit more about what you mean by that teaching being so beneficial?
It's such a wonderful question. I've only really become really written about this actually in the last year, because I undertook a PG Cert course, which is a year's course with at the Royal College of Art, and it's to do with the Teaching Excellence Framework, which is the national audit of quality of teaching. And I had the amazing opportunity to be able to undertake that course with a really fantastic tutor who encouraged all of us in that cohort to to reflect on our own teaching experience through our practice and through our research. So in many universities in this country at the moment, the research and teaching is separated. So the really cool dudes get to do their research all the time. Oh, I don't have to do any teaching. The other one trudge along, have to see more and more and more and more students. So there's this class system that's produced in universities, which is really problematic, because what it renders invisible is the incredible creativity that goes into those conversations between tutors and students. And that is where when you're looking at somebody else's work, when you're having those conversations, that is where the discourse gets worked out. And it's not just the student's work that, of course, you're attending to, that's your job, but it's also yourself, a bit like transference and countertransference in psychoanalysis. There's a very powerful and very creative space that is enabled in that learning and teaching environment between tutor and student, through the conversation, through the consideration, through the thinking, through looking at art, through a shared looking at art, and continually contextualizing and translating thoughts into other thoughts, into other versions. And so it's really the experience of writing about teaching and how teaching is connected to practice and to research that has enabled me to more properly frame what I've been doing for many, many years completely intuitively.
Thank you so much, Hermione. Thank you for your time today.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you for listening. I'm Susan Merrick, and this was Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives.